Hey all, my name is Prashant Kumar, or PK, and I'm an MCAT tutor at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. Today, we're going to be tackling five questions from the MCAT Psych So section. These are five discrete questions, and you should be taking roughly a minute each on these. But today, we're going to go more in depth so you can see exactly what's going on in my head as I tackle this section. Make sure to like and subscribe to our channel, and comment down below exactly what videos and walkthroughs you're looking forward to next so we can help tailor them to you. Let's get it. All right, great. So I've gone ahead and put the five questions we've gone through right here. So feel free to take a moment, pause the video, and come back to us. I'll go ahead and zoom in on the questions so you can take a minute to look at them. So there's one, there's two, there's three, there's four, there's five. All right, so take a moment, come back to us after you finish them. With that, let's start talking strategy. So for me, strategy around the discrete questions is very, very simple. Go quick. You wanna be quick. Make sure you're understanding what's going on, but don't spend too much time on them. These are like blessings. You don't have to read a passage. You don't have to remember things other than the content you've studied before, right? You don't have to analyze anything beforehand. So try to treat these a little quicker and don't waste too much time on them. If it's a hard question, try to get an answer, flag it, and come back to it on test day. But with that, let's get right into question number one. Which of the following best describes the inability of a company's board to brainstorm a creative solution to a business problem and instead settle on an ineffective solution in favor of maintaining group harmony? Is it A, group polarization, B, conflict theory, C, groupthink, or D, symbolic interactionism? All right, so for any psych-sos question, regardless of what it is, the question is going to have terms in the answer choices or in the question. And I need you to know the definition of these terms. The AMC pulls from a pool of terms, and these terms will come up over and over again. And you've probably seen most of these terms when you're studying. So I want you to make sure you understand, remember, memorize, whatever you need to do to really get to the root of these words or terms, because they'll come up over and over again. I can guarantee that. So in this case, we have a board that's unable to create a creative solution, and they come up with an ineffective solution. So these are key terms, right? Ineffective solution over a creative solution in favor of maintaining group harmony. So once we see this first thing, right? Maintaining group harmony, there's something we should think, right? They're just trying to maintain peace instead of creating conflict, any conflict. And they're coming up with an ineffective solution. And so if you're trying to work as a team and maintain harmony and prioritize harmony over creating an effective solution, that's the definition of groupthink, right? Groupthink is when you're prioritizing sort of being together as a community, like less friction between the team, and you oftentimes will not come to an effective solution because you're prioritizing that and you're limiting your answers to things that will maintain the harmony. So let's go through one by one the other answer choices because the terms are very, very important. So group polarization. So that's the idea that a group will start with a position and create an extreme position after discussing it as a group, right? So I'll draw it as a line, right? We have this sort of red dot as its initial. And so after the discussions and all of that, the group will actually polarize all the way to this side, maybe. It could happen the other way, where the group also polarizes to the opposite side. It just depends what the group is thinking, right? And so that's the idea of group polarization, is where we end up with a solution that is extreme compared to the one we originally have or any individual has. So we can cross out A. Conflict theory. So this is a macro sociological perspective, right? It's an idea that there will be groups and there will be, they basically have the highers and the lowers kind of thing, right? And there's conflict between these people who haves and the have-nots. So I'll draw this. And so we'll have the haves up here. So like the wealthier, the people with the resources, and the have-nots, the people without power, the people without resources, right? And so anytime that we have these sort of disparities, there will be conflict in between. I'll draw it as an X. There's like conflict in between until this haves come down and the have-nots come down and they come to a state of equilibrium. And that doesn't really occur in this answer choice. So we can eliminate B. And then symbolic interactionism doesn't really apply to this situation. It's more of definitions and meanings of terms and things come up from people interacting with them, right? And so when we have symbols in society or things that we understand, it's because people have interacted with them in a certain way. So we can eliminate D and given the meaning in that way. So question number two, a teacher tells a student to stop distracting others during class and the student changes his behavior. Which of the following best describes this change in behavior? Okay, so right away we see a situation and they're asking us for the term describing a situation. So here we're dealing with a teacher telling a student, okay? Teacher telling a student to stop distracting and the student changes the behavior. So what is the difference between a teacher and a student, right? There's a power dynamic there, right? Generally, the teacher is more powerful than the student in terms of giving out rules, making statements and punishments, all of that. So in this case, the teacher tells the student and the student obeys, right? And so that's the classic definition of obedience, right? Obedience is when you have a person in higher power telling a person in lower power to do something and they do it. Whereas conformity, right? Conformity is when they're on the same playing field. So a student is looking towards a peer, right? Not an authority figure, but someone who is on their same level. And so that is when this is defined as conformity. They change their behavior to match that of someone they're on the same level with. So we can eliminate B. Social loafing, not really a relevant term here. It's the example of when you're able to work in a group, when you're working in a group, you're not putting out your best work. You're putting out less than optimal work. And that's because you're in a large group. So social loafing doesn't really make sense here. And the bystander effect. The bystander effect is a example of you're not willing to do something because when you're in a large group of people because you think someone else will do it. So the classic example is when you see like something happen on the street, like a stabbing, you're not willing to react to it immediately because you think others will. And so that's the bystander effect. Doesn't really relate here. So remember, these terms will come up over and over again, so make sure you understand them. All right, on to question number three. Which of the following scenarios best describes belief perseverance? Is it A, an individual believes the most convincing argument after knowing nothing initially about an issue? B, an individual changes their opinion after hearing a persuasive argument? C, an individual continues to believe something after hearing a viewpoint against his belief? D, individuals in a group tend to strongly stick to their own beliefs. All right, so this question requires us to know a term and a definition almost immediately, right? There's not really anything else. It's a basic understanding of, do you know what belief perseverance is? And I think you can kind of, even if you don't remember the term exactly, sort of use the words to remember exactly what's going on, right? So what does perseverance mean? Perseverance means you have something that you're maintaining over time. And the belief perseverance is an example of that, right? You have a belief and you're maintaining it over time. The one nuanced thing about belief perseverance is you're going to maintain this belief even if someone presents contrary opinions, right? If contrary evidence is established or contrary anything, you're still going to hold on to your belief because that's what you're persevering with. You're stubborn. And so there's only one answer choice that really hammers this idea in, and that's C, right? C is saying an individual continues to believe something after hearing a viewpoint against his belief. So we have the idea that he believes something, and we also have the idea that the viewpoint is against his belief that he hears. And so with that, we have C. A doesn't make sense, right? Because you don't have that belief initially, so you're not going to say you're going to persevere anything. B, an individual changes their opinion after hearing a persuasive argument. Perseverance, not changing an argument. D, individuals in a group tend to strongly stick to their own beliefs. So this is a broad scale idea, right? Individuals in a group might maintain, stick to their own beliefs, but that doesn't really affect anything about your beliefs as an individual maintaining in spite of evidence. So that's not what the definition of the term is. So we can eliminate D as well. Onward to question four. We're 3 for 3. Let's get it. Come on. Which of the following factors has not contributed significantly to globalization? Is it A, communication, B, technology, C, economic interdependence, or D, subsistence farming? Okay, so first off, we have to understand that this is a not question, right? So we're looking for something that does not make sense here. And we're looking at globalization. And what does globalization mean? That's like the key of this question, right? Globalization is basically the connectedness of countries across the world. We're going beyond just our staple one country system, and we're becoming like a worldly view. So we're connecting Europe to North America to Australia to everywhere, right? And so how are we doing this with trade, with food, with communication, all that? So you're thinking of answer choices that don't really make sense in this. So what would help to, let's look at what helps globalization. Does A, communication help? Absolutely, right? Talking between other countries definitely helps interdependence and interrelations of globalization. Technology, definitely. There's no denying that technology connects people and connects different countries. Economic interdependence, right? Trade, tariffs, all of that. As you get to have interdependence between two countries, they're going to be more connected. So we've already eliminated A through C, so D is probably going to be our answer choice. Subsistence farming. So this requires us to understand exactly what subsistence farming is, right? Subsistence farming is you have this like threshold of stuff you need, right? Food needed. And so subsistence farming will basically farm up till this point. So farm up to this point so that the society that you're living in can survive. It's not gonna make sense for subsistence farming to really help with globalization that much. What would help is more of a commercial agriculture, a sort of a broad scale. We're making as much as we can produce so we can sell it to other countries, that type of thing. But subsistence farming doesn't really make sense in this situation. And so with that, we understand that question four is D, and we're on to our last question. Wow, we're crushing it. Let's go. So question number five. A task force of leaders from different sectors of a large economy is assembled to brainstorm solutions to emergent public health crisis. This group is best characterized as A, outgroup, B, reference group, C, primary group, or D, secondary group. All right, so this is requiring us to understand these terms again, right? These terms will come up over and over again. And so we have a situation we're going to apply these terms to. So task force of leaders, different sectors, assemble to brainstorm solutions, okay? So that's all I'm going to focus on, right? You know, they have a goal, basically, to brainstorm solutions, sure. But the main important thing is that they're leaders from different sectors, right? They're not in the same sector originally. And so let's go through the terms and see if any of them make sense, okay? So A, an outgroup. An outgroup is basically a team that doesn't have any, like a group that isn't sort of associated with the values of one. So it basically is a group that doesn't belong. And that's how I think of an outgroup, sort of like the outsides. In this case, it doesn't really make sense, right? Just because they're in different sectors doesn't mean they are completely outside of the values or they're like not the outcasts of a group in a sense. So we can send A out. So outgroup is like basically any group that doesn't belong in this group. B, a reference group, right? A reference group, just like the word sounds, reference, is a group that an individual might reference to, right? You might look to them for ideas, values, comparisons, things like that. You're looking to like your upperclassmen as like role models, things like that. Like a reference group of things you're trying to compare yourself to. B, doesn't make sense here because the leaders are not sort of referencing anything. C, a primary group. So this is comparable to D, right? Primary group, secondary group. These terms are tied. So we need to understand the difference. And the primary group is gonna be your like close ties, right? Your close values, close ties, longer term, strong values. So I would say a primary group example is classically a family, right? Very, very close, very, very like strong ties. So I'm gonna write close ties. And a secondary group is, you're not gonna have that same ties, right? You're gonna have like a little bit looser ties. You're gonna have a group that has like values and orient and goals that they're trying to accomplish. And they're put together for that reason. They're not like tied together for any other reason. And so this is more goal-oriented and I'd say like not close, but like impersonal kind of thing. You're like not really connected as well. So if we're describing this, we're talking about leaders from different sectors. Are they going to have super, super like familial close ties, right? Or are they going to be more goal-oriented, interpersonal or impersonal just for the sake of solving a problem? Probably D, right? Because we're solving a problem. In this case, it's brainstorming solutions. And so we can eliminate C and we're 5 for 5. We crushed it. Great work, team. All right. Great work, y'all. We crushed those 5 psych-soc questions. Kudos for you for getting it done. lots of great terms. And remember, I'm saying hammer those terms in if it's the last thing you do for psych-soc, right? You need to know all the terms from the practice tests just because it's from that pool and they'll keep drawing terms from the pool and you never wanna be caught just not knowing a term. So if you like this video, please like and subscribe to our channel and comment exactly what videos you wanna see next and we'll get right to them. Additionally, check out our 528 strategy series from Vikram. Super, super helpful strategies that'll help you maximize your score on test day for all of the sections. So just go check those out. And finally, click the link in our bio to sign up for our MCAT question of the day so you don't miss out on any test prep before test day. Happy studying and let's get it.